ஹலோ,
சொல்லுங்க.
பாட்டி
பாட்டி லைவ் வந்துடுச்சு.
மோர் மோர் டைம் 66 நம்பர்ஸ். ஹலோ ஹரிஷ், பிரசன்டேஷன் ஆடியபிளா இருக்கா? எல்லாருக்கும் ஹலோ, ஹலோ ஹலோ
ஹலோ,
ஆ எஸ் ஹலோ
எஸ் சார், ஐ எம் ஏபிள் டு ஹியர் யூ சார்.
ஓ, ஹரிஷ் ஸ்லைடு.
வி ஆர் ஏபிள் டு சி த ஸ்லைடு அஸ் வெல் சார்.
ஃபார் மீ இட் இஸ் நாட் விசிபிள். Okay, anyway, well, good morning, friends. I am Dr. T. Babu, HOD, Department of Instrumentation and Control Engineering, St. Joseph College of Engineering. I proudly present today's webinar with my own student, Mr. Surendra. He graduated from our college in the year 2015, and afterwards he has joined us various position in Dow Chemicals and Wipro and so on. So now presently he is doing his PG degree in Central University of Florida from the year August 2019. He is currently doing his project in IoT and this self-driving cars. He has a lot of experience with the current and core field, so that we plan to conduct this kind of webinar to our students, particularly for young minds. Definitely, it will be useful for our students. Our student community will be benefited. And about our college, it was started in the year 1994, and it is 26th year. And our college and department is accredited from the year 2003 onwards. And now 2019 also we got the accreditation for another 3 more years. Over a period, we got a NAG accreditation for with the highest score of 3.46 and a A+ accreditation status, and also NAC and NIRF ranking, national ranking framework, with 128th position all over India, including all IITs, NITs. So it is a topmost institution and have a vast experience faculties around 50% of faculties holding doctoral degree, and the rest of the people, the rest of the faculty members are doing PhD. And because the sophisticated lab and facilities we are doing the instrument control engineering for the past 25 years. So I proudly present and have this kind of the student from our department. They are the actual ambassador for our department. With this small introduction of the department and college, I am handing the session to Mr. Surendra for this session. So please, Surendra.
Yes, sir.
Take over the session. Thank you.
Sure, sir. Thank you. Good morning, all. I'm Surendra Devasundaram. I'm a graduate student researcher in Wearable Engineering and Assistive Robotics Lab in University of Central Florida. A short introduction about me. I have completed the bachelor's degree in Instrumentation and Controls in the year 2013, after which I started my career as an assistant maintenance engineer in Instrumentation Department in a gas turbine power plant. I worked there for around 3 years, where my responsibility is like doing preventive and corrective maintenance of field instruments and control systems. And later I moved on to Dow Chemicals as a process automation engineer, where I used to do control system design. And from August 2019, I am pursuing my master's degree in electrical engineering. And from December 2019, I started to work as a graduate student researcher in Wear Lab, University of Central Florida. And my areas of interest are self-driving cars, computer vision, sensor fusion, machine learning, and robotics. So today I will be presenting about controls in self-driving cars. So before we get into the topic, I would like to give a brief introduction about today's presentation format. Like, it has two parts. The first part of the presentation is designed in such a way that it will give you a basic understanding of what self-driving car is and what hardware or software architecture is being used currently in the industry. And in the second part of the presentation, I will slowly introduce you all to the research that is being conducted in this field. So when we talk about self-driving cars, so the first question is, what is a self-driving car? So just take a look at this image. This is an image of Tesla. So where the human who is sitting behind the wheel doesn't intervene at all, the vehicle by itself moves around the city. So this is called a self-driving car, which follows the rules and regulations of the particular place and reduces the human intervention in controlling the car. So the next question is, why do we need self-driving car? So the first reason is safety. In one of the survey in 2015, most of the car accidents are attributed to the human faults, and only 2% of the accidents are attributed to the faults in the car. So introducing self-driving car will definitely improve the safety aspect. And the second thing is economy. Like, since the self-driving car is running with a optimized level, so it will definitely save fuel, which is translated to savings in money. And the third reason is convenience. So here you are able to see how Mr. Bean was so innovative in building his own self-driving car. but this is not the convenience I'm talking about. So there are people out there who are not normal, maybe physically challenged, or maybe old age people. So they have a problem in driving cars. So this introduction of self-driving car will definitely help those set of the population. So driving can be divided into three tasks, which involves perception, planning, and control. So when we talk about perception, it is all about understanding the environment. Like, you identify the objects in front of you and you try to understand its behavior. In other words, it's the motion. So here I have mentioned as a static and dynamic object, which means that static objects are the road signs, the lane markings on the road, the trees, all those things that doesn't move. Whereas the dynamic objects are those which moves, like the pedestrian, the other vehicles on the road. So if you take a look at the image on the right, this image clearly shows how the top part of the image shows how the self-driving car perceives its environment, whereas the bottom part is the real real video, and the top part says how the self-driving car perceives its environment, where the pink color bounding boxes are the dynamic objects and others are all static objects. So next we talk about the planning. There are three types of planning. One is the long-term planning, the other is short-term planning, and then the immediate planning. So long-term planning is nothing but a path planning from point A to point B. Then short-term planning is nothing but a lane change or a decision that has to be taken at a intersection. And immediate planning is nothing but something that needs immediate attention, like how much should I accelerate or brake. For example, I have put here that as an example, a curved road. So how much should I accelerate or brake so that I follow the curved road? Otherwise, I may slip out of the curved road. So these are all the examples for immediate planning. And the next control is of two types, like lateral control, which is like side to side movement. In the real car, it is the steering. And then the longitudinal control, which is the forward and backward movement of the car, which is controlled by the accelerator or gas and brake. So before moving on to getting to know more about the self-driving cars, we should know the important concept called level of automation. So as the name suggests, it is the it suggests the level of autonomy that the self, the car could express. So we have around six levels. The first level, there is no automation, which means we are having only the regular car, like the one you could see on the right. It doesn't do anything on its own. Only humans are controlling it. The next level, level one, we have some driving assistance, which does a lateral or a longitudinal control. So if you see on the image on the right, it tries to adapt to the situation by increasing the speed and reducing the speed. At the same time, it tries to maintain the speed at 60 miles per hour. So here you set the speed as 60 miles per hour and it tries to maintain that speed. But at the same time, if it encounters a low distance between the following or lead vehicle, then it tries to adapt by reducing the speed and maintaining a safe distance. So the next level is the partial driving automation. So in this level, both the lateral and longitudinal control are performed. So a good example for that is the Tesla, which falls under level 2 automation, which does, if you could see here, it does both the lateral, the steering movement, as well as the forward backward, which is the longitudinal control. The next level, level 3, which is called as conditional driving automation. So in addition to level 2 tasks, level 3 has an important concept to remember. It is called OEDR, which means object and event detection and response. So from the name, one can make it out that the car has to identify or detect the objects or an event and respond to that. So for example, if I say the traffic light, then the car should have the ability to identify whether it is a red signal or a green signal. So if it does that, then we can classify that into level 3. And event detection. So if, for example, if you see here, it was able to, if there was a car in front of it, and if it identifies a collision, then it has to respond, like either stop the car or move the car or maneuver the car over the obstacle. So one of the example for level 3 automation self-driving cars are Audi A8. And then we have the level 4, which is called high driving automation. So in addition to level 3 automation, it does not require much of human attention, but still the human has to be ready to take over in case of any abnormalities. But for level 0 to 3, human attention is a must. So here I have mentioned as limited ODD. ODD is nothing but operational design domain. So the level 4 automation, or the cars that comes under level 4 automation, are limited to particular domain. Like they are designed for a specific area of working. So for example, if the car is designed to run only in highway environment, then it does the job very well for highway environment. But if we try to use that car in the urban environment, then it will be a disaster. So here on the right, if you could see, this is Waymo. This is the only company which was able to achieve level 4 automation. Here you could clearly see that nobody is sitting behind the wheel, but people are sitting on the in the passenger seats. And this is how the environment is perceived, and the awareness of the vehicle in the environment perceived. And this is the video feed of the movement of the car. So level 5. Level 5, it is full driving automation. So here we say that if one achieves level 5 automation, then it is like you can drive in any condition, whether the lighting is low or whether the weather is bad, whatever may be the condition, it should have the ability to drive through safely and efficiently. So now that we are clear about the level of automation and a few examples for each level of automation, and I forgot to mention that for level 5 automation, there are no vehicles till now. And researchers are really working hard to get or reach to that level of automation. So now that we are clear with the level of automation, let us dive deep into the hardware component of the self-driving cars. So the hardware component, obviously, if the car has to know the environment, it has to sense the environment and perceive it. So we do use sensors, and there are two purposes for this sensors. Like one, to measure the environment to and get an idea of what the environment is, and the other is to measure the state of the vehicle itself to get an awareness of the vehicle in the measured environment. So on that basis, sensors are classified as exteroceptor, the ones which measures the parameters in the environment, and then proprioceptor, the one that measures the state of the vehicle in the measured environment. So different types of exteroceptive sensors. Let us take a look at it. So the first sensor that comes to our mind is camera. So camera, the output of the camera is the image, and it takes the light reflected from the object to form the image. So if you are about to build a self-driving car, the first question that comes to your mind is like, what types of sensors I should use? What different types of sensors? And then the second question will be like, how do I select the sensor? So for the first question, we are answering it as camera. And for the second question, we have some selection criteria for each sensor. Like, for example, for camera, it is the resolution and field of view. Field of view is nothing but the area of coverage in the horizontal direction. And then dynamic range. Dynamic range is nothing but the difference between the lightest and darkest pixel in the image. And then we come across the stereo. See, stereo are also a type of camera, but it has two cameras built in, or it can also be separate, but it forms the different views of the same object, which enables us to calculate the depth of the object from the image itself. And all the criteria that is applicable to the camera is applicable to stereo camera as well. And next we move to ranging sensors like LiDAR, light detection and ranging. So the important selection parameters that needs to be considered for the selection of LiDAR are number of beams. Like the commercially available LiDARs comes with a configuration of 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64. And then points per second. So how many points it should collect per second, and then the rotation rate. So we all know that LiDAR is a rotating equipment. Only then it can cover 360 degree and give us the data of 360 degree environment. And then the field of view, as you all know, that it's the area of coverage in the horizontal direction. And the next ranging sensor is the radar. So for radar, the important selection criteria is the range, the field of view, position, and speed accuracy. So we also have, when we talk about the ranging sensors, we also say that they have a long range, medium range, and short range, which we will be looking into in detail in the following slides. So sonar is a sound navigation and ranging. So these are short range sensors, and you select based on the range and field of view and cost. So the next category of sensors are proprioceptive. Proprioceptive, as I told you before, it measures the state of the vehicle so that it can associate or create an awareness of the vehicle state in the perceived environment. So for that, we use inertial measurement unit. So inertial measurement unit is a combination of three sensors: accelerometer, gyroscope, and magnetometer. So the outcome of this IMU unit is nothing but the position and orientation of the vehicle. In addition to IMU, we also have global positioning system, GPS, which gives the accurate location of the vehicle in the environment. And then we have the wheel odometry, which is attached to the wheel of the car, which measures the wheel velocity and the distance traveled by the car. So next, so the first question of what sensor to be used and what are all the selection criteria that needs to be considered, we saw that. And now, since we know what sensors to be used, now we have to look into how these sensors should be used, in what combination these sensors should be used that will give you a good amount of detail about the environment. So as I mentioned before, the sensor configuration really depends on the domain in which the vehicle is designed for. So the first environment is the highway environment, and the second is the urban environment. In highway environment, we will look into the tasks that is being performed by the self-driving car. So it has to do emergency stop, it has to maintain speed, it has to change lanes. So these are the tasks that a self-driving car does in a highway environment. And in the urban environment, in addition to highway environment tasks, all three, they should also do or perform overtaking. When I say urban, it is the city environment. So overtaking, and then it also should take care of turning and intersections, and then also the roundabouts. So as you can see from this list, the most challenging part will be designing a self-driving car for the urban environment, because it has to do a lot, and the changes or the variation is really very big in the environment when compared to the highway environment. So if you take a look at the image on the right, this is what I was referring to as sensor configuration. I know the list of sensors, but in what combination or how to or in what placement of these sensors will make sense is what is called as configuration. So for example, if you see here a long range radar. So long range radar is used for adaptive cruise control, which is a longitudinal control, and LiDAR, it is used for emergency braking, pedestrian detection, collision avoidance. And then we have camera, it is used for traffic sign recognition, and also to acquire or perceive the environment on the lateral sides of the vehicle. And then we also have short or medium range radar. So these radars are used for cross traffic alert, blind spot detection, and rear collision warning. And then we have the short range ultrasound sensors, which are widely used in parking assist. So if you see here, camera is also used for parking assistance, and sonar is also used for parking assistance. So you may ask me, like, what is the difference between these two? So like when I have a free space, and if it is not a parallel parking, then my camera will suffice the need of parking. But if it is a tight space where I have to make a careful decision, careful move, then these short range sensors will really help a lot in accomplishing the task. So if you see the image at the bottom, you could see the list of sensors used for different scenarios. Like for detection of road signs, it uses video camera. For real-time traffic, it uses all these sensors, GPS. So this is how the configuration of the self-driving cars works. Now that we are familiar with the hardware configuration, let us move on to the software architecture. So this is a popular architecture that is being used in the industry at the present. So we may have multiple sensors, but all these sensor outputs are being utilized by these two modules, which are environment mapping and environment perception. And as the output of these two modules will be the map along with the position of the vehicle. So with the map and position of the vehicle, the motion planning module generates the planned trajectory. With the planned trajectory, the controller performs the lateral control or longitudinal control and makes sure that it accomplishes the long-term planning, that is the movement from point A to point B, through the actuation of the final elements. So first, let us look into what the environment perception module does. So the environment perception module is responsible for the localization and static object detection and dynamic object detection. So when I say localization, it is acquiring the data related to the position of the vehicle. And as I mentioned before, static and dynamic objects we have to detect. So this diagram gives a good idea of what the environment perception does. So for the localization, to find the vehicle position, we use GPS, IMU, and wheel odometry. And for dynamic object detection, we use LiDAR, cameras, and radar. And we generate the bounding box. And once the bounding box is generated, we track the dynamic object. Because if you remember in the previous slides that I mentioned that perception is nothing but identifying the object and understanding its movement. So that's why we don't stop with just detection. We move on tracking, and we also predict the motion sometimes. And so you can see here that the output of this module is a vehicle position, dynamic objects, and static objects. So next, we will look into the environment mapping. In environment mapping, we have three types of maps that is being generated or used in this module: the occupancy grid map, the localization map, the detailed map. So in occupancy grid map is nothing but it highlights the part of the map with dark color if there are obstacles, like a tree or road signs or curbs. So all these details will be marked with dark color, and the area which does not have any obstacle will have a light color. So this occupancy grid map gives us the information about collision-free path. And then we move on to localization map. So localization map is nothing but it uses LiDAR, and for every second it generates the LiDAR image, and the LiDAR image will be compared with the previous seconds image, and there the difference between these two images will be identified as dynamic objects and will be updated in the map. And the third map is nothing but the detailed map, or they also call it as HD map. So this map is prepared offline. So that is the difference between these two map and the last one. So detailed map is the one that is prepared offline. So as the name suggests, detailed map has all the details, all the specifics related to the road, like even the lane markings, the right turns or left turns, the signboards on the roads. So it has all the details. So the next module which we will be looking into is motion planning. So we already know that we have the vehicle position, the dynamic object, the static objects from the environment perception module. So even when we talk about motion planning, we have three types of planning. I wouldn't say types. It is like a hierarchy, like a machine planner, behavior planner, and local planner. So this image on the right will give a good understanding of what the motion planning module is doing. So mission planner is nothing but the point A to point B mapping. So that is the job of the mission planner. So it takes the current goal, like for example, current position, and then it generates a mission path, whether it has deviated from the mission or not. And this is given to the behavior planner. So in the behavior planner, it takes in the dynamic objects as one of the input. So Well, if you see this dynamic object in a behavior planner, that means that it is trying to acknowledge the dynamic objects. Like if there is a dynamic object, then the behavior planner generates a behavior constraint in such a way that the self-driving car should avoid or maneuver over the obstacle found. So with the behavior constraint generated and the vehicle position and dynamic object, the local planner is the one which gives the planned trajectory. Like it is the one that gives the short-term planning of whether to move forward or move to your left or right, or you have to take a left turn or right turn. So the next module which we will be talking about is the controller, and which is the main topic of this presentation as well. So when we talk about control, it does two types of control: lateral control and longitudinal control. Just to re-emphasize that lateral control is nothing but steering, and longitudinal control is the forward-backward movement, which is managed or manipulated by acceleration and brake. We will look into more detail about that in the upcoming slides. Before that, we will just try to finish the software architecture with the system supervisor as the last module. So system supervisor is nothing but it is an overall module. It's a module on a higher level which monitors the lower level modules. If it is software, then the environment perception, environment mapping, motion planning, and controller modules. So the purpose or the job of the software supervisor is to check whether these modules are performing correctly or whether they are giving an output that is within the operating range. All those things it will check, and it gives an alarm or it gives a notification if it does not happen in the right way. And when we talk about the hardware supervisor, the hardware supervisor continuously monitors the status of the sensors. Okay, so this is the second part of the presentation which I'm going to talk about. So in this part, I will be introducing you to the research topics or research that is being done related to self-driving cars. So initially, the self-driving cars or the controllers for self-driving cars were rule-based. So rule-based controllers are nothing but the parameters are set by the developers for a particular situation. So that is why they call it as rule-based. For particular scenarios, they set the parameters, and later they hand-tune it after simulation and field testing. So I'm sure that everybody could see the limitations from these two points. Like, obviously, tuning is going to take more time because it's going to be done manually. And then since it is done for a particular scenario or particular rule, it is very difficult to generalize to a new scenario. For example, I develop a rule-based controller for a particular scenario X, and if all of a sudden I am exposed to a scenario Y, then my rule-based controller will fail and the car will not function as it supposed to be. So the next drawback of the rule-based controller is that we all know that driving is considered to be a non-linear control problem. So if we try to solve it through linear methods, then it is not going to work very well. That is what it means. Like linearization of the vehicle model does not scale well. So, well, after a good amount of research done on these rule-based controllers and trying to improve that, they decided to move on to deep learning-based controllers. In deep learning-based controllers, so people got really inspired by the performance of the deep neural networks in other non-linear problems like segmentation and computer vision, image classification, and all those things. So once they saw that the neural network was able to perform better for the non-linear problems, they wanted to try it out with the driving aspect as well, because that is also a non-linear control problem. So another thing is, like, we don't have to tune it manually. It automatically optimizes based on the sensor data and the loss functions. And so it does not get any biases. So it will be able to generalize to new environments. At the same time, I would say that, yes, it will generalize to all new environments. I cannot say that, because this methods do have some limitations. So deep learning based controllers removes the separation between perception and control. So we all remember that driving task consists of perception, planning, and control. So in rule based controllers, first the perception will be done separately, and then based on the output of that module, controls are being done. But when we use a deep learning based controller, it uses a neural network right from the beginning of processing the input data and till the generation of the output data, that is the steering angle, acceleration, or brake. So limitations are based on the type of learning technique used. It requires more training data. So if it is in case of supervised training, then it definitely requires more data, training data. And robust algorithms, like as I told you, I cannot say it can generalize to all new environments. So still the algorithms are not that robust. And then we do have limitations with the computations resources. So we still haven't got the best out of it. So next, we will look into different approaches researchers took for this, for the same problem statement of vehicle control in self-driving car industries. So the two approaches were like sensor configuration and control objective. Under sensor configuration, there are one group of researchers, or even in industry, you can take, for example, Elon Musk from Tesla. They strongly believe that using camera alone will be enough to maneuver the car around the environment, because LiDARs are really very costly. But nowadays, we also have some solid state LiDARs, which are costing less. Maybe it is on the it is in the development, and I'm sure in a year or two, if they release it, it will be a game changing in this self-driving car industry. And using only ranging sensors, that's what I mentioned, like LiDARs, using only LiDARs. And then, as I mentioned before, for each type of control, we need to have a different type of configuration of the sensor. So for lateral or longitudinal. So when people approached this problem with a control objective standpoint, they tried doing it with a cascade control. So in cascade control, they were like trying to design a high level control which processes the images or sensor data and generates output that is being used by the low level controller, which does the actuation and makes the car move. And then came the end-to-end control. So in end-to-end control, as I mentioned before in the previous slide, that a single neural network is used to control or you process the input data and convert it to output prediction. So now let us look into the commonly used DL techniques, deep learning techniques. So in self-driving cars, we commonly use supervised learning and reinforcement learning. So in supervised learning, a brief introduction is like the model will, during the training, it takes the labeled data along with the labels and makes the prediction. So the objective here is to map the input, to learn a function that maps the labeled data to the output. So once the model is trained, it is put into test with unlabeled data. So if the training was good, then it will be able to label it correctly. Next next deep learning technique that is being used in self-driving cars is reinforcement learning. So reinforcement learning, there are three types of reinforcement learning. They are value-based, policy gradient, and actor critique. So whenever we say, sorry about that, reinforcement learning, we cannot forget to mention that it is modeled based on the Markov decision process. So, which is nothing but it has a tuple of the state, reward, and actions. So, here what happens is like the objective is to make the agent learn a policy. Policy is nothing but a function that maps the set of observations into actions, with the actions. So a short example is like when the agent takes a particular action, it affects the environment and changes the state, and a reward is generated. So if the reward is positive, then the agent moves in the same direction. Else, it moves in the opposite direction. So the objective is to of the agent is to learn a policy function that maps the set of observations to the action, which maximizes the reward. So So now let us look into more detail about each types of control and the research related to that. So the lateral control, first one. So lateral control and the neural networks used for lateral control started way back in 1989. Like this is the vehicle that was used in the project where the objective is to stay in the lane. So this is the, so the image on the bottom of the slide shows the view from the inside. So ALVIN is nothing but autonomous land vehicle in neural network. So it uses a simple feedforward neural network where the input is the image from the camera, and it has a hidden layer with four neurons. Just imagine, just four neurons at in 1989. and it has the output of 13 neurons, and each neuron is attributed to a particular discrete steering action. So to train this vehicle, they did it for almost like 150 meter stretch, where it has the image and also the human steering commands. So while testing it, they tried out a speed range between 5 to 55 miles per hour, and it was done up to 22 miles without steering intervention. So this is a very important term to keep in mind: without steering intervention. So the performance of the self-driving car as a system is measured with this. So if I say a vehicle X went till 10 miles without steering intervention, and if I say a vehicle Y went till 20 miles without steering intervention, then the vehicle Y is considered to be best at its job. So just imagine, in 1989 they were able to achieve like 1.6 centimeter distance from the center of the road. So the task, as I mentioned before, is to keep the vehicle in the lane. It should not go off the lane. So from the center, the deviation was only 1.6 centimeter, whereas where the human driving involves like 4 centimeter deviation from the center of the road. So it was working well at that point of time. And in the year 1998, researchers came up with the idea of combining supervised and reinforcement learning. So for that, they had a task like a lane selection strategy for highway environment. So as you might remember, that for highway environment, we only have emergency tasks, emergency stop, lane changes, and maintain speed. So they found it to be performing better. And when I say better, it is characterized by maintaining desired speed in the highway, less lane changes are done, and better traffic flow. And in the year, so the reason which was attributed to the better performance for the combination of these two learning techniques is that supervised learning has access to the previous experiences, and reinforcement learning gives the car the ability to learn more. So that was the reason attributed behind the performance enhancement of the vehicle. So in 2002, reinforcement learning as a standalone learning technique was introduced. So till then, it was not at all used as a standalone learning technique. So they developed a road following system, which means that the self-driving car has a car in front of it and has a car behind it. So it has to maintain a safe distance and maintain a proper speed. So it was able to have a continuous and online learning process. And then came the end-to-end learning in 2016. So you should remember one thing, like why we didn't have much of improvement in the deep learning based controller in the early 2000s, because as I mentioned, the computation resources, we never had a good powerful GPUs like what we have today, which is evident from this type of learning. So in 2016, we almost have very good NVIDIA GPUs and cluster systems, which are used to train a deep neural network to perform its task. So this was the first approach in which a CNN network was used for full vehicle control. Yeah, so as I mentioned, it was due to the increased computing power all these days. And another reason that is attributed to this enormous improvement is that the large public data sets were getting available. Previously, it was not available because it may not be generated, because developing a data set definitely involves huge cost. And nowadays, we also have hardware optimized for performing deep learning. So, so this amount of improvement was able to achieve. So as I mentioned, if you remember in the Alvin neural network, which was in 1989, they had only three-layer network. But now we have the ability to create deep models with any number of neurons. So the end-to-end learning was first applied in DAVE 2 project. DAVE 2 is nothing but DARPA autonomous vehicle. So DARPA is nothing but it's a research wing of a defense department in the US. So this image corresponds to the DAVE project, where they have only the center camera and they use that center camera image to steer. So the task they took for us not any lane changes, but only staying in the current lane, like how the Alvin vehicle was performing. So as I mentioned, you could see the difference. Like in 2016, we are able to train 250,000 parameters with 27 million connections. Whereas back in those days, before 2000, it was not possible at all. So next, we will talk about the optimization algorithm. So in the year between 2010 and 2014, researchers were spending more time in experimenting with different optimization algorithms like stochastic gradient descent, Adam optimizer, Nesterov's accelerated gradient, for exclusively for self-driving applications. So they had a good learning or finding from their research. Like during training, they were able to observe that Adam had the best loss convergence, but when it was put under test, Nesterov's accelerated gradient performed really better than the Adam optimizer. So they came to a conclusion that convergence of loss function is not need not be a representative of a well-trained network. So till now, they were able to get the prediction for the steering angle, the acceleration and deceleration, but they were observing some noisy behavior in that. So so the reason attributed behind this was the estimation was done at each frame with no knowledge of the previous state or actions. So to solve this problem, they started using a convolution long short-term memory recurrent neural network in the year 2017. So these type of especially recurrent neural network is always related to memory or a temporal dimension. It can handle temporal dimension or memory. So it gives the knowledge of the previous states along with the current states. So when they started using it, they were able to observe an improvement in accuracy, and there was a smoother steering variations. So before this, it was like very erratic because it did not have the knowledge of the previous states. And the one drawback of this research was like it was done, the evaluation was done offline and not online. So without when so we do not know how the system will react or respond when it is put into online evaluation mode. So, as you would have seen, that most of the research projects were related to or confined to the task of maintaining the vehicle at the center of the lathe. So, in 2018, the group of researchers focused on lane change maneuvering. So, for this, they used reinforcement learning like a deep Q network. And they have considered the following variables for implementing the lane change maneuver, like host vehicle speed, longitudinal acceleration, position, yaw angle, target lane, lane width, road curvature. So the one good thing about self-driving cars is that you will be able to easily relate to the concepts, because what we are doing manually is what we are trying to automate it. So obviously, if I have to change the lane, I should know my speed. I should know at what acceleration I am moving. So what the position of my car is if I'm doing it manually. So you can easily relate all those variables based on your driving experience. So lateral control, the reinforcement learnings mostly are done in a simulated environment. So for this one, it was just a simulated highway environment and not the urban environment. So the future works are like they are. So if you had observed properly, you can notice that the researchers were confining their problem statement or the research questions to which they are working on to a particular task. So, for example, if I train a network that does a lane change, it does not have the ability to do the other task like maintaining the vehicle inside the lane. So each one has different neural networks. So the future works in this field is like the deep neural network should do multiple actions, like the same neural network should also do the lane change and also should be having the ability to do the keep the vehicle in the lane. So so the other drawbacks, or I wouldn't say drawback, or a potential field of work is conducting training and testing in a real world scenarios than simulation. Because at the end of the day, simulation is also a computer run, and in computer, nothing is random. So now that we finished the lateral control, let's move on to longitudinal control. So longitudinal control, as I told you in the beginning of the slide or the presentation, that the forward and backward movement of the car, which is manipulated by the acceleration and brake, is called the longitudinal control. So in 2005, fuzzy reinforcement learning was implemented to carry out the longitudinal control. So for fuzzy reinforcement learning, they used a combination of a Q estimator network and a fuzzy inference system. So as I told that people usually restrict their scope for longitudinal control, it was adaptive cruise control. So which is described as the optimal tracking control problem for a complex nonlinear system. So as I mentioned, a Q estimator network and a fuzzy inference system. So Q estimator network is nothing but it estimates the Q values. So what is a Q value? So Q value is nothing but the expected reward. Like for example, if I know that if I write my homework today, I will be getting a A grade in the following day. So if I know that, I will be doing it, because that the A grade seems to be like a reward to me. So you already know what the reward is if you are in a particular state. So that is a Q value. So this network estimates that Q value for along with the current value, it will generate the actions. So based on this Q value, the fuzzy inference system tries to use the fuzzy set theory to map that Q value or the input from the QEN network to the output. Here, output is nothing but the acceleration break. So the subtask which they selected was a car following scenario. So like as I mentioned before, it was the self-driving car in between two cars. So here, if you see that the reward function was based only on spacing between the following and lead vehicle. So, but when we put it in a real time, obviously this single objective reward function will not be safe and efficient. So to overcome that, researchers started working on cooperative adaptive cruise control in 2011, where they used multi-objective reward functions. So now they are using the time headway and derivative of time headway as an input to the design of the reward function. So time headway is nothing but the measurement of distance in seconds or time. And derivative of time headway gives us the information of how close the vehicle moves with respect to other vehicles. So the desired state they chose for the experiment was 2 seconds time headway. So this is a short description about the network they use, the two neuron network, which is nothing but the time headway and derivative of time headway. So we use two neurons and one hidden layer and then three output. So the three output is nothing but accelerate, brake and do nothing. So again, they encountered an oscillatory behavior in the velocity profile. Like for example, since we are working with accelerating and braking, a erratic accelerating and braking will definitely bring about a discomfort to the passenger. So that is what they referred it to as a velocity profile. So if you remember that even we had this problem even in the lateral control where we used recurrent neural network get the knowledge of the previous states. So that is also applicable here, like you use an RNN or you define a negative reward function which is applicable for changes in acceleration. So again, they enhanced the cooperative adaptive cruise control in 2016 by using the Q learning algorithm. So this algorithm helps to reduce the learning time. So in Q learning algorithm, you don't need any model as such. So it learns by interaction with the environment. So a best performing policy is chosen after 100 learning simulation and it is put to test. So for this research, the evaluation was a stop and go environment. Like a particular car is designed to accelerate and apply brake at a particular interval of time. So yes, the outcome was it was performing really better, but still the passenger comfort is not taken into account. Even though we have developed a multi-objective reward function, but the passenger comfort is not taken into account. So then in 2019, they moved on to work with a parameterized batch actor critic reinforcement learning algorithm. So as I mentioned in the previous slides, under commonly used DL techniques, actor critic reinforcement learning is nothing but the combination of value-based and policy gradient. So the disadvantages of these two methods are overcome. So this was a new beginning. Like they designed a reward function taking into consideration both the tracking precision and the drive smoothness, which is nothing but the passenger comfort. So this was also evaluated in real world scenarios. So better performance with comfort for passengers was achieved. So the drawback of this research was it was able to so it was able to it, it was able to do well in the adjacent without the adjacent vehicles, but if it is put in a scenario where vehicles are then safety is not there and it is susceptible to crashes because the safety parameter are not considered. So this the other type of adaptive cruise control is the personalized adaptive cruise control. So we all talked about the passenger comfort and safety, but we never talked about personalized driving styles. So this project was focused on developing the personalized driving style. So how did they do that? So when the cruise control was switched on, it works based on the previous experience, but when the cruise control is switched off, the learning begins. Like it tries to learn how the owner of the car drives, and it tries to tune its weights. Few more slides. I'll just finish it off. So challenges. We have like computation, architecture, goal specification, adaptability, generalization, verification, validation, and safety. So in computation, as I mentioned, it is data and time intensive, and large data sets are not available. So diversity in data set is something we need to ensure. Like, for example, there is a 5 hour video, but the model trained in 2 hours data performs this because in 10 hours, it has the redundant data and it becomes overfitting. So in architecture, we don't have good guidelines for selecting the neural network architecture. So hyperparameter is also, tuning is also a problem. And we always maintain a small architecture because we do not have a large training data set. And then goal specification, it is exclusively related to reinforcement learning. So as I mentioned before, only if we define the reward function properly, then the task which we need to accomplish will be accomplished properly. So real world testing is expensive, and simulation is a good solution, but validation through simulation only is not enough. So safety, failure could result in death or serious harm to people. So we don't know what is happening inside the neural network. So we are not able to trust it and use it for safety critical applications. So some of the tools I would like you to look into if you are interested in doing a research on this is like Python, PyTorch, or any deep learning frameworks. And then Carla Simulator or Sumo Simulator are also available to use. It is a free version. And then we also have some data set like Kitty Benchmark, Waymo Open, Oxford Robot Car, Apollo Scope, ETH Pedestrian, Caltech Pedestrian. So they have different varieties of videos or images which you can use and use in the Carla simulator, and then you can test it out. So whenever I talk about self-driving cars in India, so the responses given to me was this: oh, the traffic in India is really very bad. I don't think self-driving cars will be possible in India. So if you see here, the animals are walking in the street. It's too congested. The roads are not proper. Yes. So the answer according to me will be like, I would say it is possible because we will be attempting a level 5 automation problem, because level 5 automation is nothing but doing with an unlimited operational design domain. So the answer to everyone who says that it is not possible, I would say this. So with this thought in our mind, let us work towards bringing new technology to our country and make a betterment in our country. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
Surinder?
Yes, sir. Can you hear me? Hello.
Hello.
So now I can take some questions. Maybe we have some 15 minutes time. So, okay, let me start from the bottom. Okay. Mission planner was not understandable. Vairashri. Okay, Vairashri, so mission planner is nothing but you know the path planning from point A to point B. So if you see the diagram, it would have said as current goal. Current goal is nothing but my current goal is to move from point A to point B. Now where I am. So it compares the current position with the planned path, and it gives direction to the behavior planner and local planner accordingly. So I hope it answers your question. And then how can we implement supervised or reinforcement learning in self-driving cars? So Aradhana Behura, we have to use a neural network. So it is like both a combination of regression and linear regression and logistic regression problem. So you have to do both the classification and predict or regress the steering angle and the acceleration or brake value. So it is done using neural networks. So if you are interested in getting to know how it is being done in real time, I would suggest you to look for Stanford course. I don't remember the name. It comes as CS231 something. Maybe you can look into that, and or you can look into some GitHub codes to get a detailed implementation about the neural networks in self-driving cars. People from electrical engineering fields, do they actually have to learn deep learning for such automation? So Sonal Barbe, to me, you shouldn't restrict yourself saying that I am an electrical engineer, so I won't learn deep learning for automation, because the combination of hardware and software is always performs better compared to the performance of the software or hardware as an individual thing. So it is better to learn. And yes, you have to learn it, and in order to implement it. Okay, so next question from Prakash. Any other intelligent tools used other than Fuzzy? Can you be more specific? Could you type in your comment for that? What do you mean by other intelligent tools? Prakash, please type in your comment. Yeah, so there was one question which I missed, like whether it will work in rain. Yeah, that's a very good question, because that's what I told, like in level 4 automation, we have some limited ODDs, and for level 5, we have unlimited. So in rain, they do work. So how do they work? If I rely totally on the camera sensor, then I am bound to crash somewhere. But if I use other sensors in addition to the camera, like LiDAR and radar, then I will definitely be able to use it in rain. But again, it is not, it is a developing field. So you cannot say that, yes, it has perfected its art of driving it in rain. So another question is, Thirukkural Kani, how much will be the impact of AI and ML in Indian cars, and when can we expect? Okay, so AI and ML, definitely it's going to have a big impact in any industry, and especially in automobiles. As I mentioned the last before slide, so people used to mock or say that it is not at all possible. But if we, the people of India, are determined, we, the engineers from India, are determined to bring a change, then I'm sure we will be bringing it up. But the immediate answer to your question will be like, there are companies or organizations, big organizations, who are trying to see the feasibility. But because it is a level 5 automation problem, they are also trying to study the feasibility of the implementation in India. And the other question is, how effective the CAN protocol in automobiles? Any better one? Yeah, so I think CAN protocol is really very good one. It is actually used in automobiles, like it integrates the sensors and I mean it is used between the sensors and the engine control unit. So Prakash, if you are there, can you? Prakash, if you're there, can you update your question? Like, what do you mean by intelligent tools? So is there any other question? Hello?
Hello, sir. Audience,
Any
questions, please. Hello.
So I would like to thank you all for joining this session. If you really liked this session, do help me out by posting your feedbacks in the LinkedIn profile of mine, Surendra Devasundaram. Okay, there was one question like any proper open tech to get ECU data. Thirukkural Kani, I'm really sorry. I don't have experience in that. So I do not know the answer for that. Okay, can you name some simulation softwares? Okay, yeah, as I mentioned, you can use Carla. You can use Sumo. I personally prefer Carla software. It is really good. So is there any other questions? So if not, then yes, Professor.
Shall we conclude this?
Yes, Professor. If there is no question, then I would like to thank you all for attending this webinar, and I would like to thank Dr. Babu sir, Harish sir, Akhila Devi madam, and all the other faculty members who were involved in arranging this webinar during this pandemic situation. And I also thank the management for helping them to organize this. I'm really very happy to present this topic, and I'm really very happy to see a lot of response from the participants. If you liked the presentation, do give me some feedbacks in my LinkedIn profile. Thank you very much.
Thank you, friends. It's a time for collecting the information about this webinar. Really, it was really useful for me, even for my research work. Definitely, it will be useful for our students and who are attending this webinar. Thank you, Surinder. First of all, the simple word thank you is not sufficient to express it here. Definitely, he is the person involving all the activities of our department. Like this, definitely, he will be in touch for future endeavors. Also, I thank the management of St. Joseph College of Engineering, Chairman Sir Dr. B. Babu Manoharan, MA, MBA, PhD, and Managing Director Madam Jessi Priya, and Director Sir Shashi Sekhar, and the Principal Sir Dr. Vatti Seyasagiri Rao Sir, and Dean Madam Dr. B. Bhargav for giving me the opportunity to organize this kind of webinars and talk. With this, I'm requesting the participants to get mail ID or any contact ID of Mr. Surinder for your future requirement. And he definitely he will be helpful to all the students and researchers and other users on behalf of the management and the St. Joseph College of Engineering. I thank all the participants and Mr. Surinder for having this wonderful session. Thank you. Thank you, sir, Surinder.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So this is my contact detail. You can contact me in LinkedIn.
All the participants, please enroll your feedback. Definitely, it will be useful for us to evaluate ourselves to conduct this kind of the seminar. Please.
And also, if you, have sir. any topic in mind which you want, you can also leave it in the feedback form. Maybe we can work on that.
Definitely, it's saying that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you all.
Okay. Good night, Surinder.
Yes, sir.
Thanks
thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye, sir. Hello.